discussion surrounding costs earlier on when someone raised the subject of discussions with the Blood First Nation about maybe doing something on their lands. Am I correct, and this is probably an alternate question, am I correct, gentlemen, in assuming that these costs and stuff that we heard described earlier on, like the engineering that SNC does, material, the labors, which run at 80%, and related costs, is that the cost that you're talking about when you answered the question earlier?
Yes, so in the transmission line, there are various components for officers.
Okay, so were those the costs that I just described? Yes or no? It's not like
yes, those are some of the costs that are incurred in building a transmission
line. So those are pretty tangible costs. Are there other costs that I haven't like addressed yet or that we haven't mentioned here tonight that include in your estimates?
I'll just run down through them really quick. There's material, labor, engineering, project construction management, land acquisition, consultation, regulatory process, intervener costs, cost of capital, recovery of some of the office costs. So all of those sort of things are part of the overall transmission costs.
So these are what an accountant for an investment person would call the tangible costs. They're easy to measure. Someone can go out, provide estimates, you can track them, you can measure them, you can report them. I'm just wondering what you attach when you look at costs for the cost of maintaining the integrity, the value of this biosphere, this biosystem. Like this. This is really a question for Altman's board of directors, okay? Because I don't think if we sat down and looked at your business case, we'd see the costs associated with putting these ecosystems at risk. And I think, as a former investment person, that if you factored in those things, you'd get a much different perspective on the cost benefit of going to other routes versus sticking to this one, which is so close to where the prairies meet the foothills and meet the mountains. There's no buffer zone for all the species to migrate and use these watersheds as transition. So, I'm guessing there aren't any costs for any of those factors included in the business case. So I'm asking the Altamont Board and all Albertans, is that a proper way of doing business here where we don't measure the environmental and the economic costs to people's sustainable agriculture and tourism businesses? I don't know if you can answer that question. I think the board can answer that question.
Some impacts are not necessarily quantified in dollars, but they are still quantified and they are still evaluated. When I went through the presentation, I talked about residential, visual, and environmental, various things that we need to evaluate, and there's various ways to evaluate them. Some of them you can cost, others you can't. But all of those sort of things are evaluated and are laid out in our facility application and are considered by our regulator, the Alberta Utilities Commission.
Yes, Paul Miller. This line affects me goes to the middle of one of my sections. So in your presentation, you said the transmission system was not to be regulated. It's considered to be public good. It seems like public good also has the concept of profit, and it also SNC-Lavalin is going to profit greatly from this line. In fact, I've heard Windfall kind of mentioned once or twice. The power generators are also going to profit from this line. Today it was mentioned there was going to be 80 other organization outfits that are going to profit from this line. I was wondering if you could tell me, out of this approximately $500 million that are going to be spent on this line, what percentage of that goes to compensate, not to profit the landowners, but to compensate the landowners?
Very roughly, the compensation and costs associated with that amount to about typically about 10% of the overall capital cost of the project.
Okay. 2%. And from my figures, that was probably pretty close to what I considered with what they are going to pay me for my mile, and calculated on that, it becomes closer to 2% of the cost of having a project.
No, it's the overall land acquisition cost, so there are some costs related to the cost of acquiring the land, but all that rolled in is about 10%, roughly 10% of the overall capital cost. That doesn't mean 10% goes to landowners, because there's costs on our side as well associated.
Well, I guess that's what I'm wondering, what costs do go to landowners? And maybe that was 2% that I was told by Alton Link earlier on this afternoon.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's correct. Now, I know it's a portion of the 10%. That's all I know right now.
I guess along with that is it seems like everybody else is allowed to profit from this line. Why not me? It probably is a major disturbance for my operation for the future. You know, why am I not allowed to profit from this operation?
Well, land acquisition is a portion of the project cost, and land acquisition, of course, is as per the requirements of the surface rates form. When we look at overall costs, we have to justify and defend what we're paying before the Alberta Utilities Commission. So that is for both the initial acquisition of land and also for the annual structure payments that we make on an annual basis to landowners for the inconvenience of having our facilities on our land and the resulting impact to those landowners. Now, we have been successful before the Alberta Utilities Commission of proposing and defending before interveners fairly substantial increases to those annual structure payments over the last few years. We continue to look for ways to increase those rates, but we can only do it in a way that we can defend before our regulator, the Alberta Utilities Commission, and in the face of interveners who are actually there saying, no, you should not pay that much for landowners. So that's the reality of our world. We've gone to bat for landowners to try to increase our rates and structure payments. We have been quite successful in doing that in the context of annual structure payments paid for transmission lines.
You've said in your documentation that this line, the cost of this line will represent roughly, I think it's 35 to 40 cent increase in the monthly power bill for the residential consumer. That sounds like it's so minuscule. I have to ask, how many residential bills are there in Alberta, and how long will this go? And if that is true, why not increase it by 20 cents and compensate the landowners to a better extent than what you are now?
So the reason we talk about the potential impact on the residential bill is that, I mean, most of our stakeholders are residences or old residences and want to know what the personal impact is to them. In the system, most of the transmission cost is actually incurred by industry and businesses, and so they are picking up a lion's share of the transmission costs in proportion to their energy uses. So it's really energy, it's very roughly, the more energy you use, the more of the overall cost that you pick up. And so that's all. Did you want to say more about this?
Yeah, so residential and farms pick up about 20% of the total cost. The remaining 80% is split between industrial and commercial users, with the largest portion going to industrial users. So I think that's around 61% is the portion that goes to industrial users, because they're the major users, they pay the major majority of the cost.
Okay, I have a comment to exactly that. I'm in real estate, And just by knowing that your line is proposed to my land devalues my property more than 50%. So it doesn't matter what you actually are going to pay to me. In my lifetime, you cannot pay what I'm losing just you proposed this line. And even as of right now, nothing has been built. I'm obligated to say that to potential buyers because this is a defect to my land. So I would be even responsible for disclosing that. So when you say, well, we give you some money and you have to see that, this is really, really pitiful because you devalue our land minimum 50%. And then if anybody thinks, you know, when they give you $10,000 or $20,000 or $30,000, it's almost nothing to what they devalue your property. That's number one.
I will respond this way. Various people, and I accept you're a real estate agent, and we've heard various views on what they believe the potential impact is. The way we approach that is that we actually commission studies to find out whether there is an impact and how much that impact is. And I've read a lot of those studies over the years, and in an agricultural environment, the impact on land value is almost nothing in the Alberta.
Thank you very much. I think if you really tell me, would show us, you know, how much you value our land. Really.
No.
So thank you very much.
We do this in a public hearing situation. So others present their case and present other evidence. I am just telling you upfront and honestly what our studies have and what the studies we've commissioned have shown. Now, there are cases where there may be an impact on a site-specific situation, and there's ways to deal with that. I'm talking in generalities in an agricultural land in Alberta. Those are the conclusions that have consistently come out of those paired analysis studies over the service area and have been vetted and have been tested in a public hearing situation. So I just needed to be honest enough for you to know that.
Okay, and when you make these studies and you come up now with that answer, now I come back to your environmental assessment. You said, well, we do all this work, right? And we make that assessment. I had actually Stantec contact me, and this company is order from Altalink to do an environmental assessment on my property. And I said, you know, how is that going to be conducted? And I have over 360 acres. And I said, what are you looking for? Oh, we look for maybe a plant. And I said, how long will you be on my land? Maybe an hour. And I said, what is when you are in that little piece? You'll find that one flower what you're looking for. And we cannot find it. So when that is the thorough assessment you make, and then I said, I would like to know which person is conducting it. And they said, okay, we'll come back to you. And then I got a phone call a few days ago. We are from Stantec. I'm so sorry. We cannot give you that as an email because our Altalink management has advised us that we should not send that to you. You can go on a public site, and this is how you can find your information. I have it on my iPhone. I can even play it to you. This is exactly the wording what Altalink did to me. And I have 4 pieces of land.
So, there are various aspects that you touched on in your question. the field work that we do is one component of our overall environmental assessment, and Ted will say a little bit more about that in a moment. I do want to say, though, that we are actually bound to not reveal certain things that are found by our consultants in terms of endangered species, for example. We're actually bound, and under legislation, we cannot reveal that, even if it's on your land. We can reveal it back to those who report to, such as Alberta Environment and Sustainable Resource Development, and we do that, and they track that. We actually don't, as Alberta, always see all of that information, and that's done so that those species are actually protected. So they're not available in the public domain, so people can't go out and damage or endanger them further. So I wanted to say that as well. Ted, is there anything more you wanted to say?
They find that in 1 hour on 360 acres?
So, just a comment on 360 acres. A couple stages happen when we engage our consultant companies. First of all, we rely on them to do an independent third-party evaluation from the environmental space. When specific to your property, they were looking for rare plants. I believe we're fast or rapidly going out of that season, and it was a rare plant specific survey. And they're only looking not at your entire parcel. They've already narrowed it down to a piece of your parcel. They're not doing a habitat evaluation on 360 acres. They're looking for a specific plant and a specific habitat on a specific part of your property. Now, when we look at the full gamut, if you could start looking at your property in April and start looking at different seasonalities and different species you look at over the course of time from April until mid to late July, they would likely have been back on your property more often.
Because certainly our negotiations with Big Blood, as they are with any other landowner, are confidential. And we have to deal, of course, in a different jurisdiction on the blood preserve than in Alberta. That's a reality that we have to deal with. And it's all part of everything that we're evaluating in our route evaluations.
And nobody wants to give me the answer. They said, we cannot answer. They promised me to send me emails with all my questions. I gave him a few, and he just sent me an email or left me a message on my answer machine saying that he was advised for Alta Lake Management not to give me anything in writing, not to send me an email. I should, whatever I want to find, I should find it on the website.
So I can't comment why they wouldn't tell you specifically who would be in their land, but typically this is a massive undertaking, and they have hundreds of people working for us, and they can't say on this day this person is going to be on your property. That's difficult for any organization to make that commitment. They can tell you that they would be there. They do phone you and tell you when they're going to be there and how long they're going to be there.
No, and I say, you know, I want to be there when somebody is there in case I give them permission to go on my land. So then they know exactly who is coming in this area to my land. So I understand, I appreciate that you were trying to excuse that, but this is how Alta Lake treats stakeholders.
Thank you, Pierre.
Thank you.
My name is Eric Hamlin. This is Investor Diesel. He just made a statement that in fact not clear.
Closer?
Okay.
He just made a statement that you do not control who does the generally in the area. However, your estimates of land requirements across this country are very high, seem very high to most of us, being social projects in the works at this time. Thus, I think that you're encouraging future wind development here, and I think you would be better put to either support, which in fact that is, it's a type of support, even towards some flexible combined cycle plants, built in the areas where the power is required, eliminating the necessity for these huge power lines across our country. We don't need them, we don't use the power down here. build a gas generator in the past is much cheaper than wind power, but the most wind is costing us a lot of money. Again, the economy, which is going to the country. I don't think we want 20 private plants scattered around here to fill us a line that you at least have been supported by estimating the pie and encouraging the development of this hybrid design. The lines we have are sufficient to cover what we have now, and maybe we don't need any more regulation. And the fact that it's very, very unreliable to you as your sixth generation shutdown, steam like a tent, or whenever it was, indicated that at that particular date, there was no wind. So where's your input from that? Build something that would be a 24/7 capacity, put it where you need it. The transmission lines can be cut down to a proper length and forget about this.
I'm hearing the frustration, and again, we are not favoring any specific form of generation. We have to allow any generators that want to connect to the system to connect. And we also are connecting gas generators, the ability to pick and choose which generators actually connect to the system in the end. Go ahead.
No, of course you don't. But by putting in that line, you're encouraging that type of generation, right?
Well,
it's your estimates that are putting this huge capacity line across this country. The development's not there at this time. If it's there, you're in fact, by putting that in, you're encouraging wind generated power.
So the reason that we structured the project the way we did, as I said to you earlier, when we started planning this project, Alberta had over 11,000 megawatts of wind interest. In fact, we had more than that at one point. So when we looked at it from the standpoint of it's not feasible from a system, and what you're talking about is operationally, it's not even feasible to have that much wind on the system. And that was how we approached it. We said, look, this is not a feasible level. What would be a feasible level given the long-term outlook for the province, given the power needs the province has, given the need for flexibility and the fact that wind is intermittent, what would be a reasonable level that would develop over a 20-year time frame? Our economic analysis came back from our forecasting analysis saying of that 11,000 at the time, only 2,700 over 20 years would be a reasonable level. Even at that, we said, we will not pre-build for 2,700 megawatts. We will wait and build this project in stages to make sure that we don't build something that isn't needed. And if this wind doesn't develop, and if the economics, the private generator economics aren't robust, then at least we have the chance to not build something that isn't needed. So we have done our best, given the framework we operate within, to try and manage the uncertainty around the wind farms and try to not build a system that ultimately won't be needed.
Okay, well, look, having taken that statement from you, if the need assessment that you did was done back when you said natural gas was very high, you've got new proven resources of shale gas in this country that keep up going for hundreds of years. We do not need wind power. It's not the theme thing that we think of. It grows like a lake across this land. If you look right up on Highway Week, then you'll see that. It's ugly, it's destructive, it's stuff that we do not need. And I feel that by going ahead and proposing this line that's way over capacity, you did the same thing in Heartland, and you were proven wrong there by some terrible launchers, and I would suspect that it would boil down to doing the same thing here. Unfortunately, once this thing is in place, we'll never repair it. Whether or bad, or used or not used, it's still here.
Instead of the side land undisturbed state for habitat protection. So when I was at one of the open houses a couple weeks ago, I said, so where do you live? This young chap staff. And he said, well, I live in Calgary. And I said, oh yeah. So he said, oh, wait a minute, I'm going to Canmore. And I said, really? Why are you going to Canmore? He said, well, for the beauty, of course. I think exactly. And then I asked, well, what kind of price do you pay us for the loss that we're sacrificing here? He said, you can't put a price on what you're losing. I said, you're right. What do residents value? Number one, top of the list. Having the ability to make decisions about what occurs on our land. That is very important to us. So by building only 2,700 megawatts, I'm not sure if it's all going to be in this area, wind farms, but you divide that out to McBride, which is the largest wind farm in Canada, correct? 75 megawatts coming to your
Yeah, no, that, I'm not sure the largest. There's much larger wind farms that are in other jurisdictions.
Well, I did get that on the website, but I could be mistaken. But then that works out to actually 36 wind farms in this area. 36. So how many people here do you think want the wind farm for transmission as well?
So,
Eric,
how many people want wind farms?
How many? Is there anybody who wants transmission? You take a pencil and draw from one substation to the next. We're talking straight across, like everyone in this part of the area.
So again, the need for wind farms or the need for any generation, there's no, in order to, the structure we have here is there's no need test for specific generating facilities because they're private entities. The only need test is for the line to connect the facility. Now, to the extent that, as you say, if you're opposed to wind farms developing on your land or in your area, the power plant application process, the approval process of the developers of those plants, any power plant, wind or otherwise, that process is designed to make sure that concerns like this are heard. And so I encourage you when wind developers in the area, talk with them, because that is part of the process. It is intended to make sure that people's views are heard at the AUC, in front of the AUC, through the power plant application process. It is the responsibility of developers to go out and do proper consultation and hear these concerns.
Okay, you guys said that you worry about protecting everything for your generation, your kids. Well, we want to protect this for our kids, our generation. Why do you need to find our parents for 57 years? It's not because we want this full of transmission lines and wind farms. Came out, there's no more public interest involved at all. Their whole thing is based on needs assessment. There's nothing about our economy, our social aspect of using what we're going to have here, nothing like that. It's all based on needs now. We're not even allowed to make a decision on how we do it. Is that true?
So the needs assessment process there's a rule. AUC publishes a rule called Rule 7. Rule 7 outlines the need to take into account all of these considerations. Environmental, social, visual, all those things are laid out in Rule 7. That is from a transmission standpoint. Power plants also have to go through, the developers have to go through an assessment process, not on the need, but on the environmental effects of the construction operation of their plants. So those are considered. And so to the extent that developers want to develop in this area, wind developers, I encourage you to find out who they are and make your concerns known through the process, through the power plant process. It's intended to give people a public venue to voice their concerns.
So how do we find out who these wind farms are working
with the turbines? So we published now, one of the changes we made in the last couple of years was we published all of the projects that are in our connection queue. So on our website, on the AESO website, all the projects that are currently in our queue are published with the name of the project. So you can get that information from our website to see who's actually indicated they want to connect. And then from there, you can follow up and try and find who that developer is and talk with them. Now, the AUC also publishes applications on their website. So if you look at their applications page, all the power plant applications have to be, are, it's a public process, they have to publish this on the AUC's website. So every developer has to go through this process, and it is in the public domain. It's either, some of the information is on our website, the AUC has the final approval, or makes the, it does the approval, and the applications with all the information to support the application is on the AUC's website for the developers. Okay. Does that answer your question or comment?
The names are published on their website, that's fine. The names mean nothing as far as land location. Could you not put a land location with the name so we can isolate it and figure out where it's at? If you want to meet the number, if you come around, we get a name like this, it's on Google, to 90% of us don't have an idea where it's at. So we get your brochure, which probably we haven't got yet, and you make it a lot easier for us to understand where all this stuff was happening.
So yeah, I hear your concern. You know, we don't, because these are private developers, we don't publish all their information. If you contact us, we can, our project managers who are dealing with those specific projects can probably help you to contact them if you're concerned. As well, on the AUC's website, they have to publish all their information. So when they put their power plant application in, they have to provide all the contact information as part of the application. That's part of the application process. They have to give a full disclosure of who it is that you can contact if you have concerns or questions about the project.
Okay, my name is Stephen Boo, and a question for Jason. I understand you were already quite a while with ASO, and were you involved in the 2008 needs assessment?
I came to the ISO in 2008, so I came here as the project was going through the regulatory process, so no, not directly.
Okay, we talked quite a bit about SATAR. SATAR is a large project, and you talk about all the other power generation there. I'm not actually only interested in the Goose Lake Tsingtao Kuli part. And just one question that I'd like to answer is, if there was no wind power, would there be a need for that line?
So the line is being built. One of the drivers of the need, I talked about the way we assess the system and do a need assessment.
If I just say, if there was no wind power.
If there was no wind development, there would be no need perhaps for that line, but there would be a need. The need for the line was further articulated that it was driven mainly by wind development. There's also demand growth, but that is a smaller component of the need.
But you, as part of the planner, tell me that if there was no wind power, that there would not be any need for that line.
If wind developers did not show the interest that they're showing, there would be no need to develop incremental transmission.
Okay, when you did your assessment in 2008, and when were the data collected that were the basis for that assessment?
It was over a period of years. So as I said, our planning process is continuous. So that had been, that those assessments on itself had been undertaken for a number of years. So it was a culmination of many years of planning.
So 2006 to 2008, would that be an accurate time?
Yep, and prior to that as well.
So do you know what the oil price development was? Do you know approximately what the oil price was at the time?
I'd say
in 2008 when you concluded the study?
The oil prices were quite high.
$150, would that sound right?
Probably $100.
Okay, and you know the oil prices today?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you know what the natural gas price was at the time in dollar per gigajoule?
It was in that time frame, it was around $12.
And it's now?
$22.
And when you drive around here and you look at the windmills, Vestas is one of the large wind turbine providers and suppliers, correct?
Yes.
The Danish supplier, do you know what the share price at the time was?
I don't have that information.
Okay, so it was $600. Would that surprise you?
I can't really comment on that.
And it is now lower than 25. So 95% of the share has been devalued. It's a European manufacturer, and there are lots of other European manufacturers. So wind power is on its way down. So if, with this information in mind, that is across the board, it's not only Vestas, it's Nordex, it's Woven, all the other women provide manufacturer. With that information in mind, you as an assessor for needs assessment, would you still support that line?
Our latest forecast, as I mentioned, we just published our latest forecast, in fact, in the last 2 weeks of the week. Our latest forecast has revised the winds, our Q has dropped off, as I said, from the time in 2009 when Saturn was approved, it was around 11,000 megawatts, it's down to just over 5,000 megawatts. We have seen a drop in wind power. We did not plan SADR to meet that large speculative interest that we saw at the time. We planned it to meet a much lower level, and we staged it to address the concerns that you're trying to address here, and that's my concern as a planner, is that because we can't control that decision on when and where generators develop, but we have an obligation to hook them up to the system, we're trying to develop plans that give us the flexibility to change course if we see a change. Now, we've seen a change, but we didn't build for the large level of wind at that time. We built for a fraction of it because we foresaw that this would not be, that 11,000 megawatts would not be economic, nor would it be operable from a system standpoint. So we planned to a level that we believed was reasonable and that would give us an appropriate, and planned it in a manner that would give us an appropriate mechanism to slow it down or defer it if there was no wind interest that actually did show up. But as I said earlier, even with the changes we've seen, the milestones for the project continue to be met. And so as long as the milestones are met, we have an obligation to build the project because we are legally obligated to hook up generators if they want to connect to our system.
Okay, so just looking at this nice automated chart that shows setup. The case Goose Lake Intercom project is only a small part of setup. How many megawatts have signed up for that? So far.
Well, so the line is part of an overall design.
Just for the crew, so
I couldn't tell you, I don't think we have exact numbers, because the way the projects connect ultimately is still going to be determined, because we're building this not just for the current projects that we know about, but projects that might come on in the future.
So how many do you know about?
I don't have that information for it. Because it is a network, we plan for the connections to the overall network in the area and not for specific pieces of lines, if that makes sense.
Okay, I have a handout here that tells me that a signed off project for 775 megawatts was canceled, and that included 37 kilometers of transmission line. Here we have 170 to 220 kilometers of least impact routing, and not a single megawatt that is signed up to it that you know of. Is that correct?
No, the way the power flows through the lines, we still have enough interest in this area that allows us to go forward with the line as planned.
Would that mean that the line is even needed if the power is generated elsewhere?
The line is still needed based on the amount of wind interest that we still see in our queue. It still meets the milestones that we had set out back in 2000.
So if there's not a single windmill or only a few windmills set up south of Pincher Creek, you'd have to take 170 to 220 kilometer transmission line to transfer a little bit of electricity that's produced either in the north or in the east?
The transfer levels on the line are tied to the milestones. So as long as the milestones continue to be met by the wind that is developing in the southern region here, we need that piece of the line to complete the circuit, to complete the network that will carry the power. So yes, we still need the line. It's still needed. Based on today's information, we monitor that closely though, as I said, if we see that project you talked about, I addressed that project earlier, instantly we went and reviewed our milestones, they are still satisfied, but we continue to monitor this on a real-time basis.
Honestly, I mean, I appreciate your answer, but I honestly don't believe that you can really believe that this line is necessary.
As a planner, I will tell you, I honestly believe this line is necessary. I am not interested in building things that we don't need in the province. That is, our objective is to develop appropriately and to make sure that development matches what is ultimately going to build in the province. So this line, I will tell you, from my perspective, it was planned in a prudent manner. We did not plan to the 11,000 plus megawatts that were in the queue. We purposely chose to develop a much smaller line at the time because we foresaw that we would be in a situation where we would see some of that interest drop out of the queue. We looked at it and said, from a reasonability standpoint, there's a lot of speculative interest in there, and as wind develops, we can't possibly see that much develop in our system. So I'll tell you honestly, I believe that this was a prudently planned project, and with the changes we've seen in the wind queue, it supports, to my mind, the way that we've planned this project.
Thank you for coming tonight. I really appreciate that you are here and that you're willing to take questions. I have been assured by AltaLink that you consider the environmental impact of your lines and you take the course of least impact. And in the event that this line travels through this area, how come there has been no consideration to the fact that it would promote wind farm development in this area? What are the environmental impacts of that wind farm development in addition to the environmental impact of this line? Why it was not considered?
So as part of the work that we're going to do, and actually as a result of the line going, or one of the routes being across the Blood Reserve, that triggers some other requirements for us under SEIA, which does include looking at cumulative effects. That's the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act, so it's a federal jurisdiction. Ted, did you want to say a bit more about that? Or?
Just to build on that a little bit. There seems to be a bit of misconception in the room that I just want to comment on, and that is that the lines on the map are not lines that are going to, that we've said these are the least impacted lines. We said these are preliminary lines that likely will be modified, and we currently don't know the level of impact that we're going to have with those lines. That's what the environmental assessment will do for us. We don't know that. What impact do we currently? That's why we do an environmental assessment. So I can appreciate everyone here is very passionate about a potential line across the property, and they have a good understanding of what's on their land, obviously. But we have to have an independent third party make that assessment. And then your second piece on cumulative assessments, right? And that is a piece of the assessment that we look at, and we currently don't have that information yet. We're in the process of, you know, gathering all that information, assessing it, and coming up with a determination.
So the cumulative assessment would have happened regardless of whether there was a route across the reserve, or is it only, like, is that cumulative assessment for that route, or does it include this route? I wasn't clear.
Okay, a cumulative assessment is a part of a federal assessment, okay? And so, with the inclusion of the Blood Route, it is assessed for the project.
Potential impact for a wind farm projects of this scale, of that scale in this area.
Okay, so the level and degree of what's included in the cumulative assessment is unknown. So would wind farms be included? The answer is yes. The extent is uncertain. So I can't predict that there's going to be 50 wind farms here or there's going to be one. So that's what I mean. It's hard for me to say that there's, because we put a transmission line here or not, there's going to be a wind farm with an X footprint. How can you make that determination? You don't know.
But there are proposed wind farms in the area, and presumably you have those locations.
There's wind zones, right? And again, we would rely on publicly available information to feed into a cumulative assessment.
Okay. I would like to just close by saying one of the comments in regards to land evaluation, the potential for land evaluation in this area, was that this is agricultural land. It is not simply agricultural land.
It is the UNESCO World Heritage Site. It is where I have chosen to build my life. It is where everybody else in this room has chosen to build a life. It's not simply agricultural land, and the devaluation is far greater than any monetary compensation we've been told we can expect.
But we do evaluate use cases that are identified in various ways